I now request Mr. Vinod Rai to deliver the 22nd Lalit Doshi Memorial Lecture on Effect of Audit, Good Governance, or Policy Paralysis. Please give him a very warm welcome.
Thank you. Shrimati Pratima Doshi, Chairperson of the Foundation, Shri Arun Bongirwar, my senior colleague and trustee of the Foundation, Mr. Sanjay Sethi, Mr. Bharat Doshi, friends and colleagues. I'm indeed very grateful to Mr. Bharat Doshi and members of the Lalit Doshi Memorial Foundation for granting me this privilege of not only speaking at a forum which has had speakers far more distinguished than me, but speaking in the memory of an exceptional bureaucrat who left such an indelible impression in a career so short of barely 26 years. Mr. Bharat Doshi, thank you very much for that very generous introduction. He has slipped in two factual inaccuracies, and I need to correct those. First one was that he said when we met for coffee, I said I'll try and agree to the date of 4th of August. And within a week, I got back to him and rearranged my diary. To be very frank, I'm today a retired, totally unemployed, and a benign private citizen. I have no diary to rearrange. But then I didn't want to commit straight hand because he might really believe that I'm on the road and no diary. So I thought I might as well take a week to confirm to him. And I was recently reading a science fiction novel called Heretics of Dune. It's by Frank Herbert. The author describes a bureaucrat as an official who works by a fixed routine without exercising intelligent judgment. He says, and I'm quoting, "Bureaucracy destroys initiative." He elaborates this by saying, "There is little a bureaucrat hates more than innovation, especially innovations that produce better results." Adjectives like rigid, negative, insensitive, unresponsive are routinely attributed to us. It is only when one learns about the careers and actions of persons like Mr. Lalit Doshi that one feels emboldened, and I feel very confident today to say wholeheartedly that any of these sweeping generalizations are totally unfounded. I did not have the privilege of meeting Mr. Lalit Doshi, but recall reading about his untimely death in Davos. I was then serving in the Ministry of Defense, and his batchmates and cardmates, and I know some of them, I think one or two, were serving in Delhi then, like Pinto, Harun Mago, not his batch, but they were in Delhi then, who talked of him in such glowing terms. They talked of him as a self-effacing personality, possessing excellent qualities of head and heart. He was never known to have or be pursuing a personal agenda, but was never found wanting in pushing his convictions and empathizing with the public he had sworn to serve. The civil servant stands on foundations fashioned by the likes of Lalit Doshi. I feel honored to stand before all of you today to pay tribute to a colleague who negated all the attributes, aforementioned attributes, that ascribed to us and makes us proud of the service that we belong to. It is very befitting that we honor him every year. He deserves it, and we need to remember such outstanding personalities to enthuse others in public service. Now, the second factual inaccuracy. At the same coffee, he said that we struck upon a topic. No. Two senior colleagues have got literally bullied into accepting this topic. And I've spent my last 3 years, as I said, as a benign private citizen, trying to run away from all the policy paralysis that I caused. And I'm not being allowed to run away, so I'm mandated to speak on this today. I have very, what should I say, docile fashion accepted that mandate. He has, of course, couched the topic in rather challenging terms on the commonly held belief that audit is a stumbling block and, in fact, leads to people being scared to exercise discretion or take decisions. Now, let me, at the very outset, dispel that notion as a bogey, as a total bogey. And it's not only a bogey, it's a total alibi for a non-performer, a total alibi for non-performance. If it were a stumbling block, let alone India, 191 other countries across the globe would not be committing harakiri by setting up organizations of auditor generals who would only delay decisions and create roadblocks. The very fact that such institutions have been created and have been given high constitutional status implies that the world leaders have seen wisdom in establishing these institutions. Now, in trying to justify this subject which has been handed out to me, I thought I will break it up into two, three stages where I would say, like to place before you a few propositions, and hopefully you will agree with me. If you do not agree with me, we can thrash it out in question answers which have been designed for today, and hopefully I'll get an opportunity to take out my jacket and establish my viewpoint on that particular issue. I thought, in a parliamentary democracy, why do we have these different pillars which have a separation of powers? Why is it today, more than any other time, that transparency, probity, and accountability in public administration has become so important? And finally, why is the CAG's mandate become so important? Does he have a societal role to play besides the oft-repeated constitutional role or role handed out to him by the Constitution in terms of doing his audit? Now, in any parliamentary democracy, the people have given themselves an elaborate devolution of powers among different institutions. Parliament and the judiciary are accountability institutions which derive a constitutional mandate to legislate and ensure that the rule of law does really prevail. However, quite often since the executive or legislature cannot discharge all the powers granted to it directly by the Constitution, it creates institutions such as the independent regulators, public auditors, election vigilance, and public service commissions with an arm's length approach for transparent and effective functioning. Embedded in the creation of these institutions is the core belief that they will be allowed independence and freedom of functioning. Permitting them such freedom only enhances the trust between the government and its people of equality, ethics, and objectivity. Any whiff of impairment in the functioning of these institutions only leads to an erosion of the credibility of government and hence weakening of the sinews of trust between a government and its people. Now, who are these accountability institutions? Nations worldwide design different institutions and indicators to ascertain how various government programs and policies are working. Ingredients of accountability and transparency are built in to ensure a reduction of waste, prevent misuse, and deploy resources where their potential is exploited to the maximum. Accountability institutions ensure that no one is above the law and is in fact accountable for his actions. They are designed to provide early warning signals to the executive about suboptimality of policies, transgression in implementation, and partnering for progress. They should not be viewed as adversarial institutions. Their partnership in development and the achievement of democratic values is as much as any other agency of government. And one such institution is that of the public auditor, which is generically referred to as a supreme audit institution. Just as you have a Supreme Court, this is the highest audit body of the country. The government represents a kind of principal and an agent relationship. You're aware of that. The principals are the main stakeholders, the public at large, or the legislature, which is their elected representative. The executive, acting as the agent of the principal or that stakeholder of the parliament, must periodically account to the principal for the use and stewardship of resources which have been voted by them and provide comfort of the extent to which the public objectives have been accomplished. The principal, which is the public at large, relies upon the audit to provide an independent and objective evaluation of the accuracy of the agent's accounting. The audit then reports on whether the agent used the resources in accordance with the wishes of the principal. It ensures parliamentary control over expenditure voted by the legislature. It also ensures the accountability of public authorities towards public monies raised and spent by them to implement policies and programs approved by the legislatures. Accountability and transparency, the two cardinal principles of a good governance in a democratic setup, depend for their observance to a very large extent on how well this public audit function is discharged. It is for this reason that legislatures of many countries the world over have ensured independence of supreme audit institutions. Be it the corporate entity in the private sector, the public sector entity, or government itself, countries and institutions the world over have been trying to ensure transparency in their operations. It speaks volumes of the vision of the architects of the Constitution that worldwide such institutions have been given an independent mandate and security of tenure. The avowed objective for the creation of such a high body is to enable it to hold the executive financially accountable to the legislature. And I wish to place these concepts before you, the concept of governance and accountability, and show how critically they are linked with each other. I also wish to discuss specifically what it means for audit to add value and not detract from any process. I would conclude with the proposition of how audit and the executive can improve the efficiency of the administration and effectiveness of government spending. Now, accountability is the obligation of those holding power to take responsibility for their behavior and actions. It becomes even more important an issue when management of government funds, of public funds, is involved. The government spends a huge amount of money in creating infrastructure, providing services, and running various schemes for the welfare of its people. A large chunk of the government's money comes from the tax, which is compulsorily collected from its citizens. You and I have no option. The government is therefore obligated to work in the interest of its citizens and deliver accountable governance. It is answerable to the public for its policies, decisions, and performance. But I must hasten to add that accountability is not the sole responsibility of government alone. It is a requirement of the corporate sector too. It also transcends into civil societies, non-governmental organizations, and citizens' groups. However, since government collects monies from the public and spends on behalf of the public, such spending does place an element of higher accountability on government. Such accountability requires that the actions and decisions taken by the public officials are transparent and capable of withstanding public scrutiny. Let us spend a moment on trying to understand how accountability has attained such an iconic status today. As I said earlier, in a democracy, ultimate power rests with the people. They elect persons who will represent them and in turn constitute an official machinery which is architectured to discharge the policy decisions undertaken by the elected representatives. In a system of separation of powers and constitutional checks and balances, accountability ensures that the actions and decisions taken by these public officials appointed by the elected representatives are subject to oversight so as to guarantee that government initiatives meet their stated objectives and respond to the needs of the community they are meant to be benefiting. Accountability is important because it ensures that public bodies are performing to their full potential, providing value for money in the provision of public services and instill confidence in the community and its government. This is the basic tenet of democracy. Democracy, any democracy without accountability is a body without a soul. Now, the conventional wisdom of good governance is premised on the basic tenet that democratically elected governments will conduct public affairs with probity and accountability. There will be transparency in their functioning. However, I dare say this, public perception due to some actions of government which have come into public domain indicate that elements of ethics and integrity seem to have been lacking in some actions taken by government. This has triggered a feeling among the vast majority of the urban citizenry that it is time when the conventional architecture along which governments are expected to function needs to be tempered, and tempered such that there is an element of participation by the informed public. Now, when government is taking decisions on behalf of the people, they have to take responsibility for those decisions, because the well-being and development of this group of people, maybe in a village, maybe in a city, maybe in a country, depends upon the choices made by these people who have been granted that authority. And the quality of such accountability is the edifice on which a vibrant democracy can be sustained. Now, as I mentioned earlier, 192 countries have created offices of the Auditor General. And in most of these countries, such Auditor General are constitutionally mandated to conduct audit of government departments and report their findings to the elected legislature. We in India also have such a mandate. It was thus that the constitution makers created the Office of the Controller and Auditor General. The constitution, to ensure independence and efficacy of the Auditor General, has provided him with a fixed tenure of 6 years. A lot of people asked me, how did we do what we did? I said, once I was sworn in, I had a fixed tenure of 6 years. So I could afford to take some of the risks that we did take. Otherwise, we would have been having Auditors General practically every year. Once appointed, he cannot be removed except by a process of impeachment with a two-third majority in Parliament. And to ensure his objectivity, Article 148 in the Constitution is the one which gives birth to the Controller and Auditor General. Article 148.4 lays down, and I quote, "The CAG shall not be eligible for further office either under the Government of India or the Government of any other state after he has ceased to hold office." I think this is an excellent provision in the Constitution, because this is to ensure his independence. It is also laid down that his budget shall be charged upon the Consolidated Fund of India and not voted as normal budgets are done, in the sense that Supreme Court and the Supreme Audit Institutions, these are charged to the by the Finance Ministry or the government cannot tamper with the budget proposed by it. It's automatically charged to the Consolidated Fund of India. Now, what needs to be introspected is whether the CAG's constitutional mandate ends the moment he has placed his report in Parliament, or is it in any way beyond this mechanical function that he performs. What I ask of you is, once the audit is done, report prepared and placed in Parliament, is it full stop? Should it finish there? Now, what happens when this report gets to Parliament? It's about roughly about 100 reports that we place in Parliament every year. These reports are supposed to be automatically referred to the Public Accounts Committee to be examined. Public Accounts Committee comprises of about 35 odd members drawn from both the houses. If they meet very often, exceedingly very often, they meet for about 25 times in one whole year. Now, if they have to examine these reports in detail, how can they do that in these 25 meetings? Then there are about 100 odd reports to be examined. So invariably, some of these reports go unexamined in detail and get be referred to the department concerned for remedial action. Now, so the question that repeatedly arises is whether the Parliament and, in fact, the public at large expect the auditor, I mean, after he's placed his report, to be a mere accountant and do arithmetic over government expenditure. If it was so, then why should the constitutions and constitutions worldwide appoint such high dignitaries as auditors general and give them constitutional positions? Evidently, what was envisioned in the Constitution was more than expecting them to be mere accountants. And to get an answer to this query, we need to look around some democracies elsewhere. But before I get to that, this was an issue which was debated and contested by the central government, and they went up to the Supreme Court to ask what is the mandate of the CAG. The Supreme Court gave a verdict, and part of the verdict, though the intellectual property right is theirs, I took it and made it the title of my book, which says, "Not Just an Accountant." The Supreme Court said the CAG is not just mere munim, in fact, that's the word used. He is not just a mere accountant. He has been given a constitutional position for holding the executive, the government, accountable to the legislature, financially accountable to the legislature. Now, when we looked around other parliamentary democracies or democracies otherwise, what is the position of the CAG? What are his actions? What is his mandate? And I thought I will quote a couple of instances to you. Let's take the case of the USA. In July 2004, the US also has Auditor General. He is known as Controller General. And the institution is known as the GAO. The acronym is the GAO. It's called the, it was called the General Accounting Office. Just as we are called the CAG, the USA calls them the General Accounting Office. In July 2004, the 110th Congress in the USA introduced an amendment, and they passed a bill to redesignate the office of the GAO, or the Controller General. the redesignated office, whilst the acronym remains the same, GAO, the full form is Government Accountability Organization. Clearly indicates the change in the mandate. Government Accounting Office, General Accounting Office, to Government Accountability Organization, which means you can see the switch in the mandate. The mandate becomes so much more larger. And this reflects the agency's evolution and additional duties. Most of the work of the GAO today is questioning the policies of government and the suboptimality of its spending, and questioning the federal government's actions. Let's take another case of a smaller country, but it's that of Estonia. Local body in Tallinn contested the fact that the CAG could not audit the local body's expenditure. The court, the Supreme Court, held that local bodies function for the welfare of the people, and the people need to be kept informed about the efficiency of their operations through an independent audit procedure, which means all bodies who are spending public money need to keep the public sensitized about what it is. These are the examples which made us reaffirm our belief that Supreme Audit institutions are indeed mandated also to sensitize public opinion. Nearer home in India, you will agree with me that civil society in India, roughly around 2010-2012, was witnessing a rare phenomenon. A phenomenon where the citizen had come center stage and was wanting to hold government accountable for its decisions. Citizens were seeking a dialogue with government and wanted to participate in decision making. They were seeking transparency in public formulations. Today's youth is far more discerning than our times. They are far more demanding, and they believe that institutions created by the constitutions should be given the independence. And when I speak of citizens groups, I'm referring to movements like that of Anna Hazare, who were questioning government's actions and saying that you must justify the actions that you were taking. What were the public seeking? A new moral and ethical framework for sustainable governance. The citizen coming center stage and wanting to be heard is indeed a phenomenon which debunks what we have known over the years, which debunks a myth of what is known as a silent majority. This voice should be heard. And this voice was never taken seriously because those in the middle class, people like you and me, sat in living rooms or drawing rooms, conducted debates amongst ourselves, never really went to the polling booth. The politician did not bother about these white-collar people. These white-collar people, with whatever opinions they had no role to play as far as the electoral practices were concerned. But since the public started exercising this pressure, lots of things started changing. And I must give you a couple of examples. If you'll remember, quite some time back, there was a chief minister of a southern state who had to demit office, who had to exit office because of the verdict of a Lok Ayukta of that state. He did demit office, he exited. But the political party concerned was not reconciled to that exit. They thought he had exited because of political or public pressure. The president of that political party went down to the capital and said, maybe what the chief minister did was immoral. He certainly did not do something illegal. I would any day have my chief minister do something which is illegal that can be rectified, but how can you say he did what is immoral? Similarly, a cabinet minister speaking at a public function, and you all will it will resonate with you in the sense that we've all heard of current account deficits, revenue deficits, fiscal deficits, etc. Trust deficit we've heard about. But the cabinet minister then said, what the country is witnessing today is a deficit of ethics. And I think that it tells it all when the minister himself of a ruling government makes this observation that there is a deficiency of ethics in the country. And that is the district paradigm shift that I'm talking about. Now, audit had to react positively towards this change. And audit did at that point of time. And it was done in a threefold fashion. First, audit had to be premised on belief that they contribute to good governance, they contribute to upgrading governance in the country or the city as much as any other agency in administration. Audit do not believe that there is a we and they relationship, an adversarial relationship or a contrarian relationship between administration and audit. Both are on the same side of the table. Their goals are common. While the administration is the expending agency of governmental resources, audit is merely the validation agency to provide comfort not only to the government but to the public at large to ensure that government funds have been efficiently expended. Once audit observations have been made, the executive now has the option of either stonewalling them or positively viewing them to make mid-course corrections in their actions. In the event of the department choosing to ignore the observations, society at large loses. There is no gainer. The efficiency of public expenditure declines. Competitive edge is lost. In the eventuality of a department or institution actively engaging with audit in exploring the ways and means to incorporate the observations and upgrade its machinery, both the parties bring value to the table and thereby improve the efficiency of the delivery process. In this process, government's credibility and legitimacy improve. On the other hand, audits have also undergone a culture change, and I need to flag this. They now engage in positive reporting. Hence, from being labeled earlier as a bunch of fault finders, who are often wiser by hindsight, they now recognize good practices and do make observations of good practices in their audit reports. Secondly, to ensure a very widespread dissemination of audit observations, both positive and negative, salient observations are reduced into what Mr. Bharat Doshi called the naughty books. I have an example of those naughty books, which are like pamphlets. We call them naughty books because this is the size. If you remember, Enid Blyton's naughty books were roughly of this thick paper. Well, certainly not meant for the kind of clientele that Enid Blyton was then catering to. But this book, in about 14 to 18 pages, contains the gist of the entire report. And of course, at the back, it has a CD, which gives the report itself. So anybody wanting to do it in this year, it's a pictorial analysis, a very good pictorial analysis of what it is. Now, this one deals with cleanliness and sanitation in Indian railways. This has cost me a good lunch, and I must explain why. We did an audit of, I don't know, some of my colleagues were in there, of sanitation on Indian railways, and this was just before the Commonwealth Games. And I had written a letter to the then minister, just before, or was it the railway board chairman. The minister invited me for a discussion on what I had written about, and I was told that lunch would follow. Meanwhile, this book with all these photographs, which do not bring out the railway cleanliness in very good light, And for no fault of mine, my colleagues had taken these photographs and pushed them there, landed up on the table of the railway minister. The discussion took place. I kept waiting. The lunch never materialized. Thirdly, what we have been doing is that we have engaged with public at large in what is known as social audits, because quite often auditor is competent in audit practices, but he doesn't have that last mile reach or local intelligence about various things. And that's where, and this is a government commenced phenomenon, because government started the process of social audits. If I remember correctly, it was Mr. Jairam Amish who started it for the NREGA program. We took it on and we engaged with credible non-governmental organizations or citizens groups working in that area to gain more details about whatever are the government expenditures, to avail of local knowledge. Now, the traditional role of a public auditor is merely to conduct financial test audit. However, the issue we have debated is whether the common citizen is really concerned whether the government's financial statements are misstated, correctly stated, not stated, or what is it. Does he bother about those issues? No, I think that he doesn't bother about those issues. The question that we need to pose is, does public audit address these issues, I said, merely placing the reports in the parliament, or do public auditors have a role far beyond that of sensitizing public opinion? We found that our answer to this has to be a resounding affirmative. Thus, we decided we will push the envelope slightly further in trying to sensitize public opinion also. Now, that is where audit was and is being labeled as activist, or reaching out to a mandate which was not necessarily their mandate. To give you an example of a case which is very well known, he talked about all the G's. I thought he was going to talk about the three C's that we normally talk about, the CVC, the CBI, and the very poor CAG. But he talked about the G, so I will also refer to a G. This was the Spectrum case, the 2G case, in which the report has been questioned, was questioned, as whether we had the mandate to do what we did. Now, let me make a very simple observation that audit has no role in public formulation. We do not get into the public formulation process. Policy formulation is the sole prerogative of government, of the elected government. Audit only implements the policy which has been formulated by the government. So if it was 2G and the government in 2008 wanted to issue licenses by a process which was called first come, first served, fair enough. Audit doesn't question that. But was first come, first served actually performed? Were the guidelines laid down really followed? Audit had not given its report on this issue as yet. In 2010, when 3G was to be introduced, government itself changed the policy and went in for auctions. Audit conducted an audit of the auction process too. We did not question either of the policies. We did indicate that in following policy X, you derived so much of resources. In following policy Y, you derived so much of resources. Now, was there suboptimality in this? Has the public exchequer lost in that process, is what we pointed out. Now, very important thing which I need to emphasize is that in doing so, audit also has to follow two principles. One, its own professionalism, its capability of upgrading its systems, its architectures, its structures, its professional capability better than the best in the world to ensure that it's able to audit well. Number two, that audit has a policy of total zero tolerance of error, zero tolerance of any Achilles heel it may have, zero tolerance of any skeletons in its cupboard. That means it must be totally, as one would say, I don't know if it's politically correct or not, Caesar's wife must be above suspicion of any kind, which means integrity, probity have to be the underpinning qualities of audit also. Now, what does this all lead to? And that's my first proposition, and I seek your endorsement on this, is that the belief that social obligation is one of the roles that audit also has to perform. And the second is for you and me assembled here in this room today to remain in a state of lethargic non-performance under the garb of complicated rules, fear of investigations, and time-consuming practices as an alibi, and hence say, we will not take decisions. We will get into a realm of what is known as policy paralysis. But I assure you, and unlike a lot of distinguished colleagues of mine who are here with 45 years of experience behind me, I would say that given a little amount of imagination, innovation, and initiative, the challenge of enabling and empowering the poor and marginalized is within the realms of possibility. All it requires is a simple innovation of processes, a slight tweaking of the rules, and sensitization of the people who work for the scheme and for whom the scheme works, and insist on timeliness of the delivery process. Now, let me say that the India story attracts worldwide attention as it involves 1/6 of the global population. The struggle for dignity and prosperity of this population through social and economic transformation is being closely watched by the rest of the world. All decisions that we take regarding political reforms and economic liberalization will have consequential global ramifications. It needs to be emphasized that ensuring all-round development and promoting inclusive growth is not the sole responsibility of government alone. It is equally the responsibility of those who have elected that government to power. The ultimate weapon of accountability in a democracy is that of the people, you and I. Hence, officials appointed to accountability institutions would only be seeking an alibi for non-performance if they chose not to exercise their mandate and succumb to pressures. Legislative empowerment for such institutions do exist, whether it's the RTI, the Information Commission, or now the alertness of the media. They have infused an element of vigilant in government functioning. And why I say these institutions of media or the public, these are institutions of what is known as vertical accountability. When the public becomes aware, or the media becomes aware, what happens? The positive contributions that it brings about is, and I would like to draw your attention to some of the instances. One is the reopening of the Jessica Lal murder case. It was closed, forgotten. It was a force of public pressure, public opinions, and people going in for PIL that it had to be opened. Another closed case of the misdemeanors of Haryana Director General of Police. If you recall that particular case where a young child had committed suicide, that case also got reopened and he was convicted. Or that of a person called Manu Sharma, son of a very powerful person who had gone to jail but spent more time on parole than he was spending within the jail. And this was also pointed out by the media. But more recently, and that's a remarkable Supreme Court order which has come out only 3 days back, where the ex-chief ministers of Uttar Pradesh, had been given sprawling bungalows for lifetime with staff to continue occupying till times immemorial. And some of these chief ministers, ex-chief ministers, were occupying positions in Delhi and occupying government bungalows there too. The court has come down and saying that these bungalows, they must vacate. And these are moments in history when the people all over the world, whether it was Occupy Wall Street or whatever it is, movements come up, and the emerging paradigm is a paradigm which is very positive. We are not new to this phenomenon in India. India demonstrated this to gain independence. India did this again when democracy was snuffed out in 1975. It was brought back in 1977, and yet again in 1991 with economic reforms that were introduced. I think India today is demonstrating its inherent strength of enforcing accountability on government through citizens' groups and maybe even media. It is undeniable that good governance can come only when it is premised on probity and transparency. We have to reinforce a culture of morality and ethics. Accountability can come only when all decision makers and those acting on behalf of government are made aware that they sit in glass houses and all their actions are open to the public and also open to oversight. We have remarkable instances wherein lack of probity, both in government and the corporate sector, though detected, could not be brought to the logical conclusion due to failure of administration and protracted litigation. Economic prosperity for Indians is not an option anymore. It is a necessity. Economic empowerment can be possible if growth is founded on good governance. Such growth is sustainable only if it is premised on an ethical code of governance. When the story of India is written, it should be written that governance was the solution and not the problem, wherein the state was the facilitator and not the predator. These edicts in our governance structure have to be an essential ingredient, as too much is at stake and for far too many people. So let us, that's my final proposition to you, let us all not sit in our ivory towers, decry the system, and resign ourselves to the belief that what is fated for us, or that is fated for us, but do take the initiative in our hands and set about ensuring accountability, cleaning up the system, and establish a sustainable model of governance which is premised on ethical standards of transparency, probity, and accountability. We can do it. In fact, we have done it. Indians who are not as gifted as those of us assembled in this auditorium today deserve it. And most importantly, we need to bequeath to Gen Next an India which is richer than what we had inherited. Thank you very much for your patience here.